We're going to read amazing facts, as we always do, starting out the book of Psalms tonight. You know, you always learn something as you read the Bible and God shows you new things. I didn't know who the smallest person in the Bible was. Did you guys know that? Who? Zacchaeus, yeah. I thought that too. And then I read Nehemiah. It was only Nehemiah. I thought that was it. But then I read further. Obadiah was only a shoe height. A shoe height. Was reading further, though. Do you know when Paul, there was a centurion that was guarding Paul, and he was so tiny, he fell asleep on his watch. You see? The Bible's amazing, right? We got to be able to interpret Scripture, right? Yeah. Interpret Scripture. You know, I had a guy one time. We were talking about holding people accountable in the ministry of U-Turn for Christ. And he said, well, the Bible says don't stand in the way of sinners, so I'm just getting out of their way. It's like, that's what you got to do. That's like, what was that movie, The Princess Bride, right? I don't think that word means what it thinks it means. Anyway, okay. All right. Let's look at these amazing facts in Psalms. And Psalms being song, awesome book of the Bible, right? Books, songs, and songs. Psalms is the longest book in the Bible. Psalms contains the longest book, which is Psalm 119, and the shortest, 117, the shortest chapters in the Bible. Psalm is the most quoted Old Testament book in the New Testament, and Psalm 110:1 is the most quoted Old Testament verse in the New Testament. And that's when it talks about these that'll make its enemies a footstool. Psalm 117 is the middle chapter of the Bible out of 1,189 total chapters. Psalms is the most messianic of all the Old Testament books, more prophecy. In that of the coming Messiah. Jesus quoted from Psalms at the beginning and at the end of his ministry. Almost every psalm contains some note of praise to God. Psalm 23, right? We know that's one of the most familiar, best known, and well-loved passages of Scripture in the Bible. No other book of the Bible is filled with devotional material and as much in expressions as Psalms is. Every great doctrine in the Bible is taught, expressed, or implied in the book of Psalms, and we'll talk about that tonight. 100 of the 150 Psalms identify the author's name. Of the 150 books and Psalms in this book, about half identify David as the author. Every attribute or characteristics of God's divine nature is found in the book of Psalms. The word praise is used over 175 times throughout Psalms. The book of Psalms is the best example in the Bible of the example of Hebrew poetry. In Psalms, the word salvation is found over 60 times, more than twice, than any other book in the Bible. And Psalms is the only book in the Bible that begins with the word blessed. Psalms has more authors than any other book in the Bible. Psalms is the only book of the Bible that's quoted by Satan. That's interesting, right? Remember when Satan quoted to Jesus in the temptation. So there's some amazing, interesting facts about the book of Psalms. Another fact I thought is interesting to me in the book of Psalms, there's a word used in the Bible that's only found in the book of Psalms, and that word is Selah. You know, you see that written in the book of Psalms, and that means a lot to me because I have a daughter. And her name is Selah. And the reason we named her, that Selah actually believes it's found in the Bible, and it's like after it makes, or found in Psalms, after a point is making, it's like pause, meditate, reflect on that, you see? And my wife and I decided to name my daughter Selah Grace, to pause and, you know, we think of her to meditate on God's grace. Psalm is songs, right? That's what psalm means, a song. You know, songs have a lot of power, don't they? They really do. I don't know about you. I'm a song guy. Any of the guys that know me know I'm always singing. some type of songs if you've been around me before. And they're not, I always do. I mean, think about this. Like, here's a story of a man named Brady, right? You know, moving on up to the top. What's that? The Jeffrey. I mean, we could just go on and on, right? Songs, it makes it, I mean, we think of things, right? We can sing it through and through. I can almost remember every word to every, I mean, song I've sang for years and years and years, and they'll just pop into my head, right, from time to time as people are talking, you know? I mean, it evokes past feelings, right? We can remember, like, where we are and what we were doing when we hear songs. Songs can have, can move great emotions in us, right? Emotion. See, that's how my head works. Now I'm going, sweet emotion. Anyway, that's how my head works. If y'all want to know what's inside my head, a song is always triggered by a word that I hear. But anyway, songs are powerful. Songs can lead us in the right way, right? Songs can lead us in the wrong way. In fact, I'll find myself sometimes the songs in my head, and I'm like, whoa, I don't need to be singing that, right? Or I can't remember that. The lyrics of that song, but it's something that I heard years and years ago that I used to listen to, and it's still there, right? Still there. Songs, good and bad. Again, it can remind you of places, events, things that happened in your life. I remember when I used to play football in high school, we used to come out to the, I can feel it coming in the air tonight. You remember that one? I can hear it, or Phil Collins, right? I hear that song, man. I smell the grass, right? I remember walking down the hill. Good memories from song. One way that the children of Israel learned about the Lord, the way truths were passed down about God, the history, God's conquest, what he had did for them, was passed down through psalms, right? They sang these songs about God, how God delivered them, and we'll go over many, many other things about the truth, attributes of God, his character, right? What he did, songs of ascent, we'll talk about that, that they sang on the way to praise the Lord, going to Jerusalem. You know, he just praising him and praising him. And that's what songs, too, I mean, they use them in temple worship, and they're so important. You know, we worship the Lord through song, right? And this is not to say anything bad. I love the new modern worship. But, you know, some people call it 7-11 worship. You ever heard that? Get seven words and sing them 11 times. You know, I mean, what I'm saying, and that's all good, but it can be sometimes not a, hymns and stuff like that had a lot of theological truth and stuff in it. And I think they're all important, right? All important. And because songs can really teach us truths and hide these truths in our hearts. We can learn the theology, the history, and that's what the Lord did through this book of Psalms. Now, Psalms, it was a very powerful book, and again, I said it was used in the worship in the temple. It is the most quoted, again, of all the all the Old Testament books. It's the most quoted book. Get this, out of 283 Old Testament quotes in the New Testament, Psalms is quoted 116 times. That's how many times Psalms is quoted in the New Testament. Now, who wrote the book of Psalms? We just said it has many authors and more authors than any other book, right? David wrote 73 of the books. 73 is attributed to David. David was the man after God's own heart, right? The shepherd boy who played the harp. Could you just imagine sometimes David just as a young boy lying, looking at the stars at night and some of those psalms that were written just about the glory of the Lord and the heavens, and he praised him. And then David wrote psalms later on in life about events in his life, right? What was taking place in David's life? 73. Moses has one psalm that's attributed to him, the sign. Asaph, 12. Solomon has two. He-Man, I didn't know He-Man. He-Man has one, and Ethan has one. So that's 100 that the author assigned. So there's There's 50 then that we don't know actually who wrote them. But we do know that Ezra is credited with compiling this book and everything together that we have today. There's many different types of psalms. There's hymns, like I said, is temple worship. The hymns like we sing in church that they used in church in the worship. There's thanksgiving songs. Again, some of those are called songs of ascent. And what does that mean? When they ascended into Jerusalem, right? When they were going to the Passover, or they would ascend. All the Israelites would be going up into hills, going up to Jerusalem, and they would sing these songs of praise together. Hundreds, thousands of people, right, together. Could you imagine that? The singing and praising the Lord as they were ascending on Jerusalem. And I think of that song like, you know, the song that's "Forever God is Faithful," right? And they would repeat that over and over. And when he delivered us from the enemy, and the flood overcome them, and forever God is faithful. And they would recount the story and the conquest of the Lord. There's psalms of lament. And a lament, that's pouring one's heart out, right? Truly. Over, you know, why? Oh, being truthful with the Lord, I mean, about how we really feel him. But at the end of those songs, psalms of lament, it says, "But I will put my trust in you, Lord." Do you see that? And how many times as believers do we maybe not try to be honest with God? I know I do, right? Has anybody ever tried to kind of not share your true feelings with the Lord? You come to the Lord in prayer and like act like everything's okay, or, you know, he already knows, right? I mean, I'm an idiot for doing that, right? I mean, but that's just our human nature. Sometimes we think that way. We might as well be truthful with the Lord, right? God, you know how I'm feeling, but hopefully, Lord, help me to stand upon your truth, right? Not go on my feelings, or this has happened, and God, to be honest, psalms of lament, we have those. There is psalms of called royal psalms. They speak of just a greatness, right, of God, as he's our king, our creator, and gives him the majesty and the glory that he deserves. There's wisdom, psalms of wisdom, that teaches us wisdom, right? We can become more wise from reading these books and applying the truth taught in many of the psalms to our lives. They're books of wisdom. There's also, amazingly, prophetic psalms. And we spoke about that a minute ago, but there's prophecy in the psalms. In fact, more prophecy in the book of Psalms than anywhere else. There is at least 92 already fulfilled prophecies that were spoken in the book of Psalms, written hundreds of years right before Jesus ever came on the scene. And that's, as Charlie Campbell was here this week, he talked about what was one of the greatest evidences, right, of the Bible being trustworthy, fulfilled prophecy, right? Amazing. He said no other religious book has that, right? Fulfilled prophecy. The Lord said, I will tell you what's going to happen before it happens. And basically, and I'm going to prove to you that I am who I am, because I'll tell you what's going to happen before it happens. Only God knows that. Let's look at a psalm that is, I think, one of the most amazing prophetic psalms, is Psalm 22. Psalms 22. There are other psalms that talk about what happened to Jesus and about Jesus. But Psalm 22, again, it's one of the most amazing. Now, another thing, I think an interesting thing to remember about Psalm 22 is, you know, the name of the psalm and the chapters and the verse numbers that we have in our Bibles aren't what they had, right? Now, first of all, they couldn't carry a Bible around with them, right? Because they didn't have the printing press yet. They had scrolls. You didn't carry big scrolls with you everywhere you go, right? That's not the way it was. Again, they memorized, right? Memorized the books. And that's what the Lord wanted them to do. It's what he wants us to do, to hide his word in our heart, in our memory, so we will not sin against him. But Psalm 22, first thing, think about this. Jesus on the cross. He's on the cross. And he says, my God, verse 1, right? My God, why have you forsaken me? So interesting, I think, is that the title of the verse of Psalms, the way they used to recognize the title of Psalms was by the first verse. Jesus on the cross saying that, saying, look what's happening right in front of your eyes. The fulfillment of Psalm 22 is taking place right here. They would have thought of Psalm 22 when they heard him say that, right? Because most of the people probably had this psalm memorized or pretty much knew mostly what this psalm was about. My God, why have you forsaken me? Far from my deliverance are the words of my groaning. Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night I have no rest. Yet you are holy, and you are enthroned upon the places. Verse 6 says, I am but a worm, not a man, reproached by men, despised by the people. All who see me sneer at me. They separate with a lip. They wag their head, saying, commit yourself to the Lord. Let him deliver you. Just what they were doing, right, to Jesus while he was on the cross. Verse 12, many bulls have surrounded me. Strong bulls of Bashan have encircled me. They open wide their mouths at me as a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue clings to its jaw. And you lay me in the dust of death, for dogs have surrounded me. A band of evildoers has encompassed me. Check this out. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They look at me and they stare. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. You see that? Amazing, right? my God, why have you forsaken me? Look, right here, you should have known, Israel, right? You should have known. This was prophesied right here, what is taking place right in front of your eyes. Masonic Psalm. Masonic Psalm 92, again, of those specific prophecies fulfilled in the book of Psalms. Out of all those facts and all those things that we read in Psalms and we can get from Psalms, I think the best thing about it is where our faith, theology, real life, and emotion intersect. Do you understand what I'm saying? Think about this, where our real life, theology, faith, our emotions, they all meet. What do I mean by that? Sometimes you may know theology, right? But how do you apply that theology to your life? You know? I mean, and a lot of people know. I remember when I was in college, I took Old Testament and New Testament. And I had a book, I had seen some professors before. It wasn't mine, but some of the other ones in the department were not believers, right? They taught the book. It was not a Christian college, per se, but they taught this book as a historical document or as a work of literature, you see? And they looked at it as that. Now, they could have told you theological truth all day, right? They didn't believe it. It didn't affect their life at all. Psalms deals with real life, real emotion, and applies them to things that are going on in our daily lives. Just like I talked about David, right? He wrote Psalms about his true feelings, the trials he faced, how God had given him victories. Think about this. No matter what issue, trial you face in life, you can find help with it in the book of Psalms. You really can. That's amazing, right? Again, where the rubber meets the road. The Bible says that we're supposed to take every thought captive into the obedience of Christ Jesus. What does that mean? I had a session today. I had an opportunity to meet with a guy who's a friend of the family who's been going through some real tough things in his life. And he's hopefully a couple of weeks ago had given his life to the Lord. And I was trying to kind of explain these things to him and encouraging them. He was real torn up over events that had taken place and was a wreck. But I was telling him it's how you see life and truth, where you place your value at, and how you, what's really important to you in life and what you believe affects all your decisions and emotions, right? And he didn't place any value on the Lord. His father had died in some different things years ago. And as many do, or it can happen, he's blaming himself on it and different things like that. But he had never thought about the encouragement, really, that his dad was a believer, right? The truth is, where's his dad? His dad's in heaven, right? His dad's in heaven. He had never placed truth in his life of as a believer, now accepting that God sees him as forgiven, right? He accepted the Lord a few weeks ago, but he's still holding on to all this guilt and condemnation, his worry and anxiety that's tearing him up. But what does the Bible say? Anybody who's in Christ is what? A new creation. Old things have passed away and all things have become new, right? Do we believe it? Do we believe that and accept that as truth or not? And we could go on and on about where theology meets truth. But David and these other psalmists are real. The Bible is supposed to affect our life, right? If we believe it and we put our faith in it, it is our foundation. These are some of the things of issues of life that Psalms deal with. This is a short list. Psalms of fleeing enemies. There's a psalm of losing a child, of being rescued from death after faltering in your faith, after a moral failure. It's a psalm dealing with that. Of being betrayed by someone, being a prisoner of war, a psalm about being homeless. There's psalms about victory and God's blessing, right? And how to deal with that, giving him honor and praise. I mean, it's all in there. You know, that's one thing I love about the Bible. And that's another evidence. And I think Charlie might have talked about this a little bit, but do you know most religious books try to make the characters and the heroes, if you will, to be larger than life? Do you know what I mean? Like, almost God themselves, right? And it doesn't like to speak bad of them or talk about any of their failures. I mean, the Bible's full of that, right? It's the truth. The characters were sinners, right? Even the great men of God had a sin nature, and they all had failures and made mistakes, and the Bible tells the truth about that. But David is our example, especially in the book of Psalms, goes through his whole life and writes many songs about his life and how he failed, how he was betrayed. But in the end, he always came back, but Lord, I'm going to put my trust in you. I'm going to choose, right, God, to believe what you say. Hey, and that's a word for us today, right? Word for us today. Every situation that we face in life, the Bible has an answer for. In fact, the Lord talks about there's nothing new under the sun, right? I mean, it's all been done before. Any problem or things, I mean, it's happened before. And through those trials, through everything that's going on, we've got a Lord that loves us so much, that we've got his promises that we can hold on to. And he says, in this world, we may have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Is that not a hope? We grieve, right? But not as those who have no hope. Why? And we have a hope. We have a hope. And hopefully, and we all fail in this, but hopefully, as we mature, if you will, as believers, or some people say, as I walk longer with the Lord, or as we go through this process of sanctification, as the Bible calls it theologically, right? That we can trust Him more and more, right? We learn, God, I can trust You. God, You are in control. Lord, I can cast my cares upon You. Because You are faithful, Lord. God, I understand that You're working out all things for my good, and I believe that. I don't know what in the world's going on here, but I know that You got it. I don't like it, but I trust You, right? Faith, exercising our faith. We see it through the book of Psalms. And what I want to do here is just take a few minutes. And let's look, I would just say it's my favorite, but as I was going through the book of Psalms, just some psalms that really speak to me, that deal with different life issues and things, and let's see some truth that we can find in the book of Psalms and how wonderful they are. It won't do it justice totally. It starts off amazingly, right, with Psalm 1. One of my favorite psalms, Psalm 1, says, "How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked," and here's that verse, "nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night." And he, this man who does the will of God, right, who tries to be different than the world and delights in the Lord, look at what happens. "He will be like a tree firmly planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and its leaves does not wither, and in whatever he does, he prospers." But now contrast the wicked, right? "The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff, which the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the day of judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish." And there's some truth in that psalm, right? Psalm gets right down to it. Man. And I love that. I love that psalm. That I love the verse about faith in the Bible when it says that without faith it's impossible to please God. Because the one who comes to Him must believe not only in who He is, but that He is a rewarder of anyone who diligently seeks Him. Do you see that? I mean, there's a reward for, I mean, it's not, we're not really just after, but there is. I mean, our faith is not in vain, right? I mean, there's a reward for following Him. Eternal life, heaven, I mean, in just the fact that we have a relationship with Him. Just as He told Abraham, right? I am your great reward. Relationship with God. There's a reward for that. And we see if we commit our way to the Lord that we are going to prosper. And does that always mean financially? Does that always, not always that. But we're going to prosper, right? For eternity, forever. But the wicked, not so. They're going to fall in the day of destruction. Another psalm, Psalm 8. "O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is Your name in all the earth, who have displayed Your splendor above the heavens. From the mouth of infants and nursing babes You have established strength because of Your adversaries to make the enemy and the revengeful cease." I love this. "When I consider Your heavens, the work of Your fingers, the moon and the stars which You have ordained. And what is man that You take thought of him, and the son of man that You care for him," or that You love him. You see, the God that made the universe loves me, loves you. Is that not amazing? You know how small we are? One thing that blows my mind, I like listening to astronomer sometimes and things, and talking about the size and the scope of the universe. And honestly, the human mind can't really fathom it. Well, you start talking about the distances and different galaxies, and you're just like, whoa, what? And we're this little speck, right? I'm talking about Earth. It's this little speck in the cosmos. And then we are even a smaller little speck on the earth. We have no power, no strength, nothing we can really do. But yet, God loves us so much. Another psalm, Psalm 16. This is, I don't want to say, keep saying favorite, or this is kind of a life verse for me since I became a Christian. Psalm 16, verse 6. And it says, the lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. And I just love that, man. And what that means, I mean, life is good. I'm at peace. That's what that means to me. It's like, wow, I know God. He provides for me. I could be 1,000 other places doing 1,000 different things. I have safety, I have food, I have shelter, I have family. Whoa. Man, God is good to me. The lines have fallen in pleasant places. It is well with my soul. With my soul. That's what that means to me. And that is, David's able to say that in that psalm. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Man, my inheritance is beautiful to me. Psalm 23, I think that deserves a reading. The most popular psalm in the Bible. But, man, if we meditate on its truth and what it says, the Lord is my shepherd. Wow. He's the one who guides me, the one who cares for me, the one who instructs me, the one who loves me, the one who has my well-being at heart. He's also the one who corrects me and disciplines me, right? When he sees me headed into trouble. He's the one who takes care of me when I'm sick or I'm hurt. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. And he restores my soul. Again, we see peace there, right? Laying down by the still waters. You know, Jesus came, he wants to give us what he calls rest. Rest for our souls. And you know, I really believe as the Bible talks about different things spiritually and there's different types, I really think that one, and most commentators and stuff would agree, but when you talk about, a lot of people think, you know, crossing over the Jordan is like being saved or whatever, but it's really entering in to God's rest, right? People that they cross over to where they totally trust the Lord in their life. Not everybody gets there, right? Not every believer enters rest because they're still worried and about so many things. They never truly get to a point of rest. But God wants us, as he says, to take his yoke upon us, right? Because he's gentle and humble to the heart. He'll give us rest. He wants us to lay down. To lay down, to be able to live life, not all anxious and worried all the time, but just beside the quiet waters. Restores our souls, guides us in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. And I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that's an awesome psalm, right? Is there not some truth in there in times of trouble that we can go to? God, wow. You've got it, right? God, you've got it. You are my shepherd. 32. Is another psalm. And believe me, the ones I'm skipping over, they're all just as, this is just some that really speaks to me. How blessed is he whose, verse 1, how blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered, and how blessed is the man whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and whose spirit there is no deceit. You see that? How blessed are we to be forgiven, right? How blessed are we to receive God's forgiveness. And what should that forgiveness produce in our life? Forgiveness from God, a realization of that truth, should produce some things, right? It should bear what the Bible calls fruit, right? It should bear fruit in our life. We don't want to serve God because we have to serve Him because He commands us to. Because He's forgiven our sin. We want to serve Him, right? We want to love Him. We want to be in His Word. We want to spend time with Him. We want to tell people about Him. Because He's covered our sin. He's restored our souls. Psalm 40. Actually, you too sing Psalm 40. I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me out of the pit, out of destruction, out of the miry clay. He set my foot upon a rock. He put a new song of praise in to Him. Many will see and fear and will trust in the Lord. That's what He's did for many of us. He brought us out of a miry pit, right, of life that we got stuck in. Oh, and He took us out, cleaned us up, and put our feet upon a rock. Put a new song in our heart, man. A song of praise to Him. 42. As the deer pants for the water brooks, my soul pants for You, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? As a deer pants for the water, our soul thirsts for the Lord. Do you know there's nothing else that's going to satisfy, right? Jesus says, out of me flows rivers of living water. And whoever drinks of those waters never thirst again. And then in the opposite of that, many people, it says, go to the broken cisterns of this world. That's broken vessels that hold water. And there's no water in it, right? Trying to get quenched. And that's going to the pleasures of sin, of the flesh, of the things of this world, trying to find fulfillment and peace. And it comes up empty, right? As my soul, as a deer pants for the water brooks, our souls, man, they long for God. And He's the only thing that can quench that. 46, God is our refuge. Here's our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change. Right? Things are going to change. And it says the mountains will slip and fall into the sea again. That's like saying in another way, in this world there's going to be tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Don't fear, your shepherd has got you. He is our refuge, our strength, our very present help in time of trouble. 51. I'm going to talk about Psalm 51 for a moment. Psalm 51 is a psalm. We talk about truth and being real. This is a psalm of David that David wrote after a major moral failing, if you will, falter of his faith. David, this man after God's own heart, who did love the Lord, made some major mistakes, and he committed adultery with Bathsheba, right? And then to cover the adultery up, he committed murder and was lying for a year, living a lie, and to cover that, because you imagine how David felt, right? He had, and I know some of us, we did things like that before, just turn off that speed, I don't want anything to do with the Lord and feeling dry and empty inside. And then David was confronted with his sin, and he confessed. He confessed. He said, I'm the man. And he asked God for forgiveness. And he wrote this psalm after that. And let's just read a little bit of it in Psalm 51. Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. My sin is ever before me. Against you and you alone have I sinned, and I've done evil in your sight. And you see, he confesses to the Lord, and he says, you know, it's really only against the Lord we can sin, right? I mean, it is him. He set the standards, and we sin against the Lord. And he's the one we ask for forgiveness. Verse 9 says, hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not you take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain with me a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will be converted to you. You see that? That's repentance. That's a man. That's David saying, God, just don't take your Holy Spirit from me. God, this relationship, this please, forgive me, Lord, and let me get back a right relationship with you, God, because I am miserable, right? I have no peace. And he's begging God for peace again and for forgiveness and his soul to be restored and be made whole. And then he says, do this, Lord, and I'll teach others your ways, right? And people, and you know, God uses us many times through trials, doesn't he? And 2 Corinthians, the book starts talking about that. It says, hey, many times we've been through things before because we can minister to other people who go through the same things, right? And we can do a test, we can give a testimony, right? We can testify, we can tell what God has done for us. That's a testimony. And people want to hear, hey, when somebody's going through something, they want to know that somebody else has gone through a similar thing, right? And they want to know, they want to be comforted, and they want to be encouraged. And if you've been through something, God can take what you've been through, and he can use that as a blessing now in your life to bless others with. And there's people that only you can minister to because of specific things you have been through, right? God can do that. And you can teach transgressors his ways and tell other people about his love so they may be converted. Psalm 73. I love Psalm 73. I use it a lot in teaching, especially in the minute of U-turn for Christ, because Psalm 73 is a leader of Israel, a man who knows the Lord, and he says, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart, but as for me, my feet almost slipped, right? And what this guy is saying is, I almost fell, because I looked out in the prosperity of the arrogant and the wicked, and it seemed like they had it made, right? And I kind of put that into this world, looking out at the rock stars, looking out at the drug dealers or whatever, you know, looking out at the maybe corrupt politicians or whatever it may be. People who seem to have a lot and have got it by dishonest means or not and aren't following the Lord, right? And looking at them and being envious and saying, man, what am I doing all this for? I'm trying to do the right thing here. And man, they've got everything that the world offers, and here I am struggling. That's what he's saying. As for me, my feet almost slipped. But, verse 16 says, when I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight until I came into the sanctuary of God and I understood their final end. You see that? Combat the truth in our lives, right? Where does that life lead to? They're going to have pleasure in this life, what, for a little while? And then they're going to what? Face judgment. And they're going to go to hell. And a believer receives God's forgiveness. and lives in eternity with him. Is there really any choice? No, not really in that perspective. In that perspective, Psalm 73 tells us that truth, reminds us of that truth. Psalm 119, again, we said that's the longest book in the Bible. There's a lot of amazing things in Psalm 119, but just a verse, verse 9, how can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word with all my your heart, I have sought you. Do not let me wander. Your commandments, your word I have treasured in my heart that I may not sin against you. That's a verse we memorize in You Turn for Christ, a great verse. And how can we keep our way pure? When I was meeting with the guy today, and we determined, and he was able to gather, one of the problems that he has in life is he doesn't know any of the word of God, nothing. He knows none of God's truths, so there's nothing to stand upon, right? There's nothing to believe because he doesn't know it. And that's why it's so important for us to hide God, to know God's word, so we can believe it, and so we can live it, and we can commit our way to it. And then we may not sin against him, at least as much, right? All right, 122. I was glad when they said, I say this one a lot. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. We should be glad, right? To be able to gather in the Lord's house, we should be glad. We should be happy about going to church. We should be happy about fellowshipping with other believers. It should not be a drudgery. I remember thinking sometimes when I was young, it was a drudgery. I had the wrong perspective, right? It should be a joyous occasion that we look forward to. We get to meet with God. We get to hear God's truth. We get to fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. Psalm 131. I just got this one, so maybe y'all can understand what I say when I say this. Sometimes I say, I plead Psalm 131, and most people don't know what I'm talking about. Here it is. Oh Lord, my heart is not proud, nor my eyes haughty. Nor do I involve myself in matters that are too great for me. Surely I have composed and quieted my soul like a winged child rests against his mother. My soul is like a winged child within me. O Israel, hope in the Lord from this time and forevermore. You see that? And it says, I say that when like people are having these great theological debates about something that I mean, you know, it doesn't really matter about salvation, but there's all this. I'm like, I plead Psalm 31. You know, I'm just saying, man, doesn't really matter to me. I just trust the Lord, right? And anyway, I say that sometimes. Plead Psalm 31. 133, how good and how pleasant it is when brothers dwell together in unity. Isn't that what God wants for us? Brothers and sisters in Christ. For us to get along, right? It is like precious oil upon the head coming down upon the beard of Aaron. And that's a symbol of the Holy Spirit, right? Being filled and covered. How pleasant it is when believers get along, when brothers and sisters get along. Psalm 136, I mentioned a psalm of ascent, and we've sang many songs that use this psalm, but give thanks to the Lord for he is good. His loving kindness is everlasting. Give thanks to the God of gods. And it goes on. But I can see them just repeating this over and over on ascending into Jerusalem. Give thanks to the Lord, right? Forever he is good. His loving kindness is everlasting. Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and you have known me. You know when I sit down and you know when I rise up. And you understand my thoughts from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down, and you are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before there is a word on my tongue, you know it all. And that psalm just tells us that God knows us, he loves us, he's intimately acquainted with us. Amen. And that's the relationship that we have with him. And again, there's 150 psalms. And Christ is all throughout the Psalms. It talks about Him as our shepherd. It says He is our all in all, among many other things. All the prophetic Psalms that we have that talk about Christ. But I hope we can just take away tonight that when we have issues in our lives, things we're going through, other people have been through the same things, and there is an answer. And the answer is always the Lord. Let's be honest and real, and let's use these truths in the book of Psalms to increase our faith and to also share with others. Let's teach them to our children, right? Songs are powerful. Songs are powerful. So let's sing a couple more songs here tonight. Ask the worship team to come up. We'll praise Him. I ask prayer warriors to come forth. And if you need prayer, I'd encourage you. We'll be up here. Come forward. We'd love to pray for you. If you just want to kneel at the altar and pray, you can do that. You can do that. Father, I just thank You so much, God, for Your loving kindness, God, Your mercy, the fact that You are concerned with us, that You're on our thoughts, God, and on our minds, that You love us. And I pray that that truth can penetrate our hearts. I pray that we can learn, Father, to always be mindful of You and of Your word and of Your promises and what's real, Father. Not be tossed to and fro by emotions and things that aren't real, God. We know that we have an enemy that came to steal, kill, and destroy, and He wants us to be all worried and anxious and stressed. But God, we know that You came to give us peace and rest. Help us to walk in it, Lord. We know we can only do that by Your Spirit, God. Fill us with Your Holy Spirit. May we walk in the Spirit, not fulfill the desires of our flesh, knowing that there is a reward, God. This is not in vain. We love You. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.